Now we realize, after seeing the scenario, that who has the monopoly on terrorism? And according to me, terrorism is a monopoly of the politicians. According to my understanding and survey, terrorism is a monopoly of the politicians. Irrespective, they may be politicians of USA, of UK or India, it is the monopoly of the politicians. We have to realize what is the cause of terrorism. If we want to abolish terrorism, first we have to understand the root cause. I, being a doctor, we don't believe in symptomatic treatment. We believe in trying and finding out what is the cause and killing the germ. That's a better treatment. What is the cause of terrorism? The experts say that the cause of terrorism is injustice. When injustice is done on a particular group of people, when wrong is done on a particular group of people, they tend to retaliate. And that is the only cause of terrorism. And when we realize that, whether it be the 9/11, the destruction of the Twin Towers in New York, whether it be the 7th July, the bombing in London, or the serial bomb blast 93 in Bombay, or the recent bomb blast on 11th of July, whether it be the thousands of people killed in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Gujarat, in Bosnia, whether it be in Palestine, in Lebanon, we find that behind them, the main cause are the politicians. I was wondering that when I landed in UK, that why were 21 young Muslims arrested? The government said we were keeping track on them for several months. Many people I met who knew these people who were arrested personally, they said impossible, they can't be involved. What we realize that the people wait, when should this news come out? At that time, Israel was attacking Lebanon. Thousands of people were killed. The Britishers were objecting. So then you have a diversion. 21 Muslims supposed to bomb the airline are arrested. It's a bigger news, so people forget about thousands of innocent people being killed in Lebanon. Same thing in India, Kargil. Any problem, politicians, talk about Kargil, talk about the enemy, Pakistan. Diversion, politics, whether it be in USA, whether it be in UK, whether it be in India. The major cause are the politicians. We know that our country, more than 60 years back, they were ruled by the Britishers, and they had a policy of divide and rule. More than 50 years back, we got freedom from the Britishers, but unfortunately, they have left, but they have left the policy behind. And our Indian politicians, they have adopted this policy of divide and rule. They adopt this policy of divide and rule for the vote bank. From records, we come to know that the country which has the maximum riots anywhere in the world, it is India. If not daily, at least once a week, we have communal riots. This great country of ours, so many great religions are there. Maximum riots, communal riots. And the major cause, almost all, directly and indirectly, they are the politicians. For the vote bank, for the power, for the money, they engineer these things. Otherwise, normally, I have met non-Muslims. It's my job, it's my profession. I'm a student of comparative religion. I keep on meeting different sorts of people. Generally, the common Indian, irrespective whether it's Hindu or a Muslim, they would love to live with each other harmoniously. They would love to live peacefully. We may have our differences. We don't want to fight. But it is these politicians. It is these politicians who engineer hatred amongst different religions so that they could fill their vote bank. And you see, almost all the riots that have taken place, indirectly or directly, they are the cause. We know that a few years back, there was a political gimmick, the Babri Masjid and Ram Janmabhoomi issue. You know, Babri Masjid, Ram Janmabhoomi issue in Ayodhya. I would like to know how many of us Muslims and Hindus knew about Babri Masjid and Ram Janmabhoomi before the politicians made it a gimmick. How many of us knew? I had never heard of this, Babri Masjid. And when I asked the common Hindu, he had never heard of this. Only after the politicians made it a political gimmick, people knew about it. And we know, on the 6th of December, 1992, they wanted to have a big procession, a gathering at this site. The Supreme Court had explicitly said that no gathering anywhere close to the disputed site. A group of politicians They make it a political gimmick of Ram Janmabhoomi issue and the Babri Masjid issue. They want to gather on 6th of December. The ruling politicians know very well that they have the Supreme Court backing. They could have easily stopped the gathering, easily. But then they think, if I stop, I may lose vote. So they let the gathering take place. The gathering takes place, and then they say, spontaneously, the thousands of cars were gathered there. Spontaneously, the Babri Masjid was destroyed, spontaneously. You know, there was live recording on the various satellite channels. We know that with trishuls and lathis, how can you get down a structure? Is it possible? No. They had planted explosives. With this pre-planned act that planted explosives, anyone can see. You don't have to be a specialist of military. You can see it with your eyes. That explosive were planted, and that's how the structure came down. Can the structure come down with lathis and trishuls? Maybe George Bush saw this. 6th December 1992, that's how he had conducted the inside job of 11th September. Time does not permit me to speak about the inside job. That requires a lecture by itself. Inside job of 11th September. Many Americans have spoken about that. Maybe he saw it and he got the idea that let's conduct in New York also. Later on, what happens? This emerges into riots. Throughout the country, there were riots. It is the largest riot after partition in the whole country, where tens of thousands of innocent human beings were killed, mainly Muslims. Who's to blame? The innocent Indians. They are instigated by the politicians. Fight, kill the opposite religion people. Instigated, innocent people, they get instigated, and they do the act. We know that even in Bombay, one of the cities that was maximum affected was Bombay. Even during partition, the riot that took place in Bombay was the worst in the history of Bombay. Even during partition, so many people were not killed as during the December 92 and January 93 riots. The police, if they wanted, they could have easily prevented the riot, very easy. With the backing of the reserve police, with the backing of the military, easily they could have done it, but they did not do it. Most of them were silent spectators. Some were good, they tried, but they were in a minority. Majority were silent spectators, some were party to it. I'm aware that even the police is controlled by the politicians. So the police wants to do something, the politicians come in between. So the blame goes back to the politicians. Later on, the government appoints a single judge commission to appease the minority. And they appointed Justice Sri Krishna. It was famously called as the Sri Krishna Commission. And we know that Justice Sri Krishna, he was and is a devout and a practicing Hindu. But at the same time, he's an upright and honest judge, just like how we have Justice Suresh here. An honest and an upright judge. The verdict he gave, it did not go down the throat of the government. It takes a few years. And he had analyzed the full cases of the riots. He spoke with the politicians, with the police. Individually, he visited 26 police stations, analyzed the records, spoke with the police officer, junior and senior, spoke with the victims, spoke with the media, and after a great deal of research, he presented, we have this damning verdict of Sri Krishna Commission. He even gave suggestions, how can we prevent these riots? But you know, it takes time. By the time this happened, the government says bygones are bygones. Because they know if they implement the report, they are afraid that they will lose the vote bank. At that time, to appease the minority, they appointed the commission. How many commissions? I don't know. How many commissions have been implemented? I think Justice Suresh can tell. How many commissions that they appoint have really been implemented in India? How many? So here we know it is a delaying tactics. The innocent Indians, especially the Muslim victims, we have faith in the judiciary system of India. If the politicians betray us, if our other citizen fellow members betray us, if the police betrays us, in this country, we have yet faith in the judiciary system. And we know that finally, most of the innocent people, whether they are arrested, etc., they are finally released. But the damage done to them, it cannot be undone. Later on, we come to know, after a couple of months, on 12th of March, 1993, there was a series of 13 bomb blasts in Bombay, in which more than 250 innocent citizens of Bombay were killed. More than 250 innocent human beings were killed. And more than 700 human beings were injured. The opposition said, oh, planned everything. Justice Shri Krishna said, it was not meticulously planned, it was a retaliation. More than 1,500 innocent Muslims killed in riots in Bombay. More than 1,500 innocent Muslims during the Bombay riots of December 92 and January 93 were killed. It was a retaliation. And the authorities and the police said it was done by Muslim underworld with the help of some others. That's how the bomb blast took place. And they say, all of them agreed, even the police commissioner, they agreed that it was a retaliation to what had happened in Bombay. We know that immediately after the riots of December 92 and January 93, it was difficult for the Muslims to walk on the streets. It was difficult for him to travel in the train, travel in the bus, to work in a non-Muslim area. They were looked down upon, they were ridiculed. Immediately after 12th March 93 bomb blast, those scenario changes. Most of the Muslims, they know that killing innocent people is prohibited. Yet, they had a soft corner for these people who did the bomb blast. They were happy internally. In Islam, two wrongs don't make a right. Islam condemned this act. Killing innocent human being is to be condemned. You cannot kill innocent human being if somebody else has done injustice to you. You can't kill a third person even if you belong to the same community. Islam prohibits that. Whoever did it, whether Muslims or non-Muslims, whoever killed more than 250 innocent human beings on 12th March 1993, Islam condemns it. Most of the Muslims knew that killing innocent people is haram, it is prohibited, yet they were internally happy. But you cannot use wrong means to reach a right goal. You cannot. Islam does not permit that you use a wrong method to reach a right goal. There cannot be any justification. We realize that Muslims are harassed, they were tortured, they were killed, but you can't justify the killing of innocent human beings. Imagine the family of those more than 250 innocent human beings. When they come to know that the Muslims have killed us, they will think, what kind of religion is this? What wrong did they do? Did they harass you? The person who has harassed you, if you catch him and put him to trial and he's a culprit and you punish him, no problem. All religions give you permission. The innocent people killed on the street, what wrong they did to you? Imagine, he will become a permanent enemy of Islam. Islam does not justify the killing of any innocent human being. It is to be condemned. When we realize the chain of sequence of events, who is to be blamed? We come to know that prevention is better than cure. Who is to be blamed? When we see the sequence of events, we come to know that if the opposition politicians, the politician from the opposition party, if they would not have used Babri Masjid and Ram Janmabhoomi issue as a political plank, the Bombay bomb blast in 93 wouldn't have taken place. Later on, the politicians in power, they could have easily prevented the gathering. They could have easily prevented the destruction of the Babri Masjid. Easily. They had the Supreme Court verdict. They had the military, they had the police, but they were afraid that if we do it, we'll lose vote bank, so they let the destruction take place. Second people responsible are the politicians in power. Third people, the innocent Indians, they are instigated against the minority and they involve in killing of thousands of innocent Muslims. They are too responsible, but they're innocent people. Fourth people responsible is the police. The police could have easily prevented the riots in Bombay or anywhere in India, easily. The normal civilians, we aren't military trained. We cannot fight with the police. It's easy. It's very easy for the police of any city, especially Bombay, to prevent the riots. Very easy. Preventing terrorist attacks is difficult. I'll come to it later on. But riots is very easy. Easy. But they didn't do it. Some were afraid. There were a few who went out of the way and helped the innocent victims. But the majority were silent spectators. Some even were party to it. Some who were silent spectators, they were afraid that if we went against the politician, we would have been transferred. They too are to be blamed. Fourth people to be blamed are the police. Fifth, last, but not the least, the people who committed this bomb blast. Islam does not give permission to use wrong means to reach the right goal. All five categories are to be equally blamed. If you want to stop terrorist attacks, go to the root cause. Stop the injustice. Stop the wrong done to a particular group of people, and terrorism will stop. It is difficult for the police to stop the bomb blast. We know, we understand. It's not easy, it's difficult. But to stop the riots, very easy. Same case. You see most of the riots that took place in India, they have the same sequence, same people involved, the details may differ. Same group of people involved.